I heard an old, old story, how a Savior came from glory, how He gave His life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about His glory, of His precious blood atoning, and I repented of my sin and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with His redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew Him, and all my love is to Him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. Now I heard about a mansion He has built for me in glory, and I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea. I've heard the angels singing and the old redemption story, and some sweet day I'll sing of them the song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with His redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew Him, and all my love is to Him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing blood.
Oh, down at the cross where my Savior died, down where the cleansing blood sealed my cry, there to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to His name. Glory to His name. Glory to His name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to His name. Oh, I am so wondrously saved from sin. Jesus so sweetly abides within. There at the cross where He took me in. Glory to His name. Glory to His name. Glory to His name. There to my heart was the blood applied. Glory to His name. Oh, come to this fountain so rich and sweet. Cast thy poor soul at the Savior's feet. Plunge in today and be made complete. Glory to His name.
Make the pathway clear. Paul and team. Good to see y'all tonight. How are you? This is quite a different story than last Wednesday, huh? Weather-wise, yeah. Welcome back to springtime in Texas. Yeah. I want to remind you before we pray about February the 6th. That would be a week from tomorrow. Week from tomorrow. Can you believe February already? February the 6th. We will meet for a prayer walk at the corner of, depends on who you are, Pedernales or Perdinalis, and Silver Spur. If you don't know where that is, then go out the driveway, turn right. Go down to, what is that, Rocky Hollow Creek Drive, right? Yeah. Isn't that what that is? Rocky Hollow Creek, whatever it is. And go that way, and when you get to the stop sign, turn left. Go across the bridge and up to the top of the hill, and you'll be in a perfect place. We'll meet there at 10 o'clock on Thursday morning, February the 6th, and we'll either walk, or if you're unable to walk, ride around the territory there and pray for, we can pray for the workers who are building houses and doing all that construction. We can pray for the people who are already there, and there's a number of homes already occupied, and we can pray for those who are yet to come. I remember at our trustee retreat 2012, I think it was, that we, at the end of the retreat, we took a little tour. I said I wanted us to go to the area where Sun City was growing. And at the time, it was, down this way from Cool Spring and up on the hill. And there were nobody living up there yet, but there was a lot of construction going on. So E.M. Hay took us up there, and he said, let's take back one of these rocks. Just pick up a good-sized rock. So we picked it up. And if you come into the boardroom at the worship place over at Sun City, you'll see that big rock on the boardroom table. It is there to remind us of all the people that are yet to come to Sun City, and they are a part of the harvest. God has called us to reach out to our neighbors and make sure that they have a home in heaven, that they know the Lord Jesus Christ as Savior, so that's what that's all about. So Thursday morning, will it be the next week? It'll be this coming week, won't it? Yeah, because the next week, some of us will be in Haiti, right? But Thursday morning, 10 o'clock, we'll meet at the corner of Pedernales and Silver Spur and pray for that territory. Just like we did back when what was then called the Queen's Track opened up. Remember that? Some of you were there. And then every Thursday forward after February the 6th, we'll have a 10 o'clock prayer time over at the library, Sun City Campus, and you can come pray with that group. Our Wednesday morning 10:45 group, we're pretty much filling up the table, so we decided to start another group, and maybe you can come at 10 o'clock on Thursday rather than 10:45 on Wednesday. That's a good thing, isn't it? Yeah, praying. Prayer should never be our last effort. It ought to be our first, right? When all else fails, did you forget to pray? Yeah. Let's pray, and then we'll get into our Bible study. We got some traveling to do. We got to get back across the lake, Sea of Galilee, Tiberias. Yeah. Everybody good? Let's come go to the throne of God's grace tonight. Father, we bow before you in Jesus' name to say thank you for the day and for the good food that we've enjoyed, for the wonderful music that we sing. We sing to you, Lord, and we sing about you, Lord, because we love you. We've come to know you in your power and in your grace and mercy, and we can't help but sing. We are delighted to be called your children. We're delighted that you have rescued us, set us free from our bondage to sin, and you've set us free to live for you and in Christ. We pray, Lord, tonight for our family, that we call it the worship place, but it's our family, that there are those who are hurting, struggling, grieving, hurting in many ways. We lift them up to you, Lord. And for those of us who just think that life is perfect, help us not to become complacent in your goodness and grace, but always to be thankful for every breath we take, for every gift from above. For we know that you are the Father who gives good gifts. We pray, Lord, tonight for our country and for this world. And we know, Father, that there's much trouble in the world. There's not only the trouble as in sickness and death and sorrow, but there's so much evil. There's so much suffering that's caused by evil. Lord, we pray for forgiveness. We pray for mercy. We pray for your power, Lord, to be a part of changing the world, that thy kingdom may come on earth as it is in heaven. Father, we know that the end will come someday. Perhaps today, we do not know. But Lord, we pray that we are prepared, that we're busy doing the work that you've called us to do, and that we're faithful to the calling you've put upon our lives, that we would be busy doing the work, accomplishing the mission that you gave us. Lord, we pray for the power of your Spirit tonight. Lord, we open ourselves to you. If there's some way, Lord, that we can just open ourselves up to you and let go of trying to control everything, just let your Spirit speak to us through your word. Lord, I submit myself, my voice to you tonight and ask you, Lord, to use me as an instrument of your truth and your love and grace and mercy and power and your glory. Thank you, Father, for the opportunity to study. I pray, Father, for those that weren't able to be here tonight, for those that maybe sit at home watching TV and just forgot or have come complacent, Lord, we pray for them. We don't point fingers at them. We want them to be involved in your word and in your study, becoming more like Christ. So, Father, help us to remember every Wednesday to remind our neighbors to come study with us. Lord, we love you and we lift your name on high. Amen. I was asked to remind you that when you leave here tonight about 7 o'clock, if you'll look to the western sky, you'll see the evening star. That is the planet Venus. Is that right? Which I'm told is also the morning star, but you can't see it right now. But you'll see a bright red, orangish glow in the sky, and that is probably brighter now than it is many other times of the year. So look at God's beauty when you go out tonight, enjoying the coolness of the day. I'm told that the weather app says that it's going to be cold tomorrow, so I hope you enjoyed today. Well, are you ready to travel? Where were we last week? Let's just get some refresher. Where were we last week? Who remembers? We crossed the Sea of Tiberias, or the Sea of Galilee. We crossed over from, let me turn around and face the way. We crossed over from the northwest over to the, stayed at the top of the Sea of Galilee and just went across about six miles or so, probably at night. Each of us had our oar and we were rowing across, and had a little storm that night, and we had to wake Jesus up and calm things down. But we got across the lake and met this guy. We called him the Gerasene demoniac, yeah. And we saw Jesus speak healing into this man's life. He set the man free from this legion of demons, unclean, impure spirits, whatever they are. It was controlling his life, causing him to cut himself and be apart from his family and loved ones, living in the caves, in the tombs. And Jesus set him free. And remember what he told him when the man wanted to go back across with Jesus? Remember what the man said, or what Jesus said to the man? No, don't go with me. I appreciate that very much, but I want you to go home to your people, the people that know you, the people who've known you and know how crazy your life was. Go home to them and report to them what the Lord has done for you and how He had mercy on you. Remember, mercy is when you don't get what you deserve, the punishment, for example, and grace is when you get something you don't deserve, blessing. So tell people about God's mercy. So now we've got to get back across to the lake. We're going back across to Capernaum, okay? We're going to look at the story of the healing of two women. So let's go there. Here's where we are. We're going to go from the land of the region of the Gerasenes, or the little town of Gadara. We're going to go back to Capernaum, right on the Sea of Galilee, right? And then if we get there, we're going to journey down to Nazareth, okay? Well, I hope we will, but we won't rush. If we don't get there, we'll get there next week, right? Anybody in a hurry? Okay, next slide, please. Where are we going? Next slide. There's the story. There's the scripture that we're going to use. We're going to focus mainly on Luke's gospel, but it's recorded in all three of these. And then the life. I'll go to the next slide. Let me talk for a minute about, again, our goal in this study on, we call it WEBS, Wednesday Evening Bible Study. Our goal is to walk with Jesus, to learn the places that he went and the culture of that day, that time, that era. I've been listening to some audio books. One right now that's one of those, what do they call them, great lectures or whatever. This thing is like 20-something hours long about history. And I'm listening right now about the Greek culture. But whether it was Greek culture, later Roman, and same statistics apply. Because up until more recent history, and still true in some parts of the world, life expectancy was much, much shorter. Today, you look it up on your smart device there, and you'll find out that life expectancy in the good old USA is somewhere in the neighborhood of 79, 80 years. So those of you who are beyond 80, you're blessed of the Lord, right? You're helping the average move up. Thank you. Because the older you get, the more likely I am to get older, right? So 79, let's just round it off to 80 years. Average life expectancy. And as I understand it, that's taking all births, all lives into consideration, right? Everybody that's born life. You know, I don't think it takes into consideration abortions, but all life, you know, people who are born, life expectancy is 79 years. So that means that those who die very young, there's got to be some folks who live to be 80, 90, or 100 to help bring that average up. So in Galilee, around the year 30, this is the year you know, that we're talking, around the first century A.D. Galilee, the average life expectancy is 35 to 40 years old. In other words, we'd all be, well, not all of us, because somebody would have to live in order for that to be. Can you imagine? Can you imagine living in a time when you didn't expect to live more than 40 years and you'd be gone? Well, got to keep in mind that one of the reasons the life expectancy is only 40 years old, because so many people, so many bodies, human beings, died very young. In fact, the infant mortality rate, some say as high as 50%, but certainly, all the resources I looked at said, certainly a minimum of 25%. In fact, what's the infant mortality rate in America right now? They do it by 1,000 births, right? So five out of 1,000 children born in America, born alive, right? Out of 1,000 children, 5 or 6 of them will die by the time they're 1 year old. That's all, 5 or 6. That's very low. And of course, if it's my child, that'd be very high, wouldn't it? But 5 or 6. Can you imagine 250 out of 1,000? Not to mention the number of women who died in childbirth. Some argue that 10% died in childbirth. So life expectancy of 35, 40 years, you can see why it is. Half of the 10-year-olds, again, in this culture, 30 AD, Middle East, well, probably all over the world, about half of the 10-year-olds make it to the age of 50. So that's a just totally different way of thinking about life, isn't it? So here's what stirs in my mind. So how do I think about life if these facts are true? What is my view of life, my philosophy? Do I think, well, heck, you're only going to live 35, 40 years anyway, you know, go. Or do you say, I'm only going to live 35, 40 years, and so I'm going to be very cautious, very, I mean, how does that impact the way you think about how you're going to live every day? I mean, most of us, I would say, well, at what point do you begin to think about the reality of death? Unless something, an accident or disease or something brings it into reality for you. At what point do you begin to think about your own mortality? I mean, we talk about young and dumb. In fact, there's country music songs about that, you know, being young and dumb and doing all kind of crazy things. We as a teenager, early 20s, we think we're invincible. We can do anything, you know. I remember my dad one time. We had this great big, about 5-acre lake, pond, whatever, that he had dug on the place. And a couple of my buddies and I, there were no trees around it, so we put up a light pole and made us a swing around there. And I remember my dad saying, son, you're old enough now, you got to think about getting injured and such that you couldn't earn a living anymore, things like that. Just trying to bring home the reality that you're not invincible, that you could be injured. Yeah. So mortality rate. Those kind of things are very, very important for us to consider as we think about how things were different then than they are now. You get sick, what do you say? Well, I need to go see the doctor. What if there are no doctors? What if there is no hospital, no doc. I mean, there may be some sort of medicine man or a religious man that would pray for you, whatever, but this thing of, well, shoot, I'll just go get some medicine and fix that, or put a bandage on, stitch that up, or, I mean, there's so many things today that they can fix, cure, whatever, and we just moving right on that 100 years ago was a death sentence. I mean, so many things. But how does that influence how we read the Bible? We're going to look at a couple of samples tonight of how that might affect how you think about it. So let's go to the next slide. We're going to look at the map again, make sure that we're on the right track, right? The map on the right is the Sea of Galilee, Sea of Tiberias, whatever. And so we've been over here, and we're going to go back to Capernaum, right? Capernaum, right up there. And here's the Sea of Galilee again with a little bit bigger. The Gerasenes, the question mark, not sure. Gadara, I think, is right up in here. There's Gadara down there. You know. And so remember this region of Decapolis, the 10 cities. Decapolis is a Greek word, right? Greek culture had a big influence on, well, all the Mediterranean world for centuries. Yeah. And continuing to do so. Has great impact on our culture. Greek did. And so I want us to see the Sea of Galilee, go to Capernaum right up here on the northwest corner, and then I hope tonight that we'll get to go to Nazareth. And I'm going to show you the trail that we're going to take to get there. All right, so everybody, you got your personal flotation device, and you grab an oar, and we're going to make the few hours trek back across the Sea of Galilee and leave that man behind and move on. All right, let me see where I want to go. Yeah, before I go to the next slide, let me share some thoughts with you. So we're returning from Gadara or area of the Gerasenes. How much sleep are we coming back the same? I mean, right after you heal the guy and the people said, we don't want you around here, get back in the boat and go back across? I'm making that assumption. And if so, when did we get any rest? When did we eat? No mention of that. And so it may be that you're going back across the lake with an empty stomach and trying to stay awake. Of course, it's probably pretty easy to stay awake pulling on that oar. Might get a little cap nap. Jesus did on the way across coming over. Have you seen the T-shirt? I meant to put a picture up there of one. Coletti and I were at a gospel music singing. I think it was up in Fort Worth back in November. Could have been somewhere else, but They had, somebody was selling these T-shirts, said to follow Jesus, take a nap. And I thought, what does that have to do with following Jesus? And then it occurred to me, oh yeah, he was taking a nap in the front of the boat, and they had to wake him up because they were afraid they were going to drown. So if you want to follow Jesus, one of the things you get to do is take a nap. But not now, please. And so it is, what's going to happen when you get back to the shore, back to your town of Capernaum? Well, more than likely, there is a crowd there too. Because it's gotten to the point that Jesus is so well known for the miracles that he can do. People are following him like the the paparazzis or whatever. But instead of taking pictures, they want to be touched. They want to be healed. They want to be fed, things like that. So there are crowds of people around all the time. And so no rest for the weary. I think my opinion is that's why Jesus went across the lake to begin with, was to get rest. But he didn't get it. He didn't get it. So can you put yourself in Jesus' shoes? Again, he's 100% man. He is God, but he's how tired. Maybe you're one of the disciples. Jesus, when can't we just float a while and not have to row this boat? I don't know. But following Jesus is hard work. And there seems to be a common theme that runs through the healing of the demoniac that we just experienced there over in the land of the Gerasenes, and the woman with the issue of blood, that's Jairus' daughter, that we'll read about here in a moment. It's this, that they're both considered, that is the Gerasene demoniac because of his being with the swine and all these things, and the woman because of her issue of blood, both of them are ritually unclean. So they're both outcasts. They both are pushed away from the community, the family, and all that kind of stuff. So both of these have that in common. Demons and blood and death made the individual unclean. But also, remember this, that if I am unclean and you touch me, what does that make you? You're unclean too. So and this is the thing about Jesus. What did he do that other people evidently didn't? Touch. He touched him. That sounds like a good title for a song. He touched me. Yeah. Or the touch of the master's hand about the old violin, you know. Yeah. We'll get to that later. Let's see, where do I want to go? Yeah, let's go. This issue of the little girl, we'll get there in a minute as far as reading the text from Luke chapter 8, but think with me for a moment before we read it. This is a child, 12 years old, only child, 12 years old. She is a Jew. We're back across the lake now, so it's a Jewish girl, 12 years old. Again, the cultural issue, the bar mitzvah or the bat mitzvah, the age at which a person, a boy or girl, would become an adult, a man, woman, 12 years old. And also, at the age of 12, they could be a member of the synagogue as well. That was important, too. And so, here's a woman who's been having this issue for 12 years, unable to have another child, the prospects of more children very slim. Again, the mortality rate of in childbirth is sad. And so here we're going to meet this guy, Jairus, or some say Jairus, a synagogue ruler, and we'll see what that means in a moment. But he's a prominent member of the community for sure. When Coletti and I moved to St. Joseph, Louisiana, it's a real small town. It was a thriving community back in the early part of the 1900s, cotton country, Delta. But since all these big tractors and technology and stuff, you know, one man can do what probably 1,000 mules and slaves could do 200 years ago. But the community just dwindling down. But I remember when we moved there, we met a man named Johnny Coor. Johnny was in his mid-80s. He was a World War II Pacific veteran, and he was Mr. St. Joseph Baptist Church. If you want to know anything about the church, he could tell you. If there was anything to be fixed at the church, he would be right there to fix it, whether it be painting the handrail or, you know, getting somebody to repair the roof. Johnny Gore. And so that's the way I think of the synagogue ruler in this case, because they were different officials in the synagogue. Somebody had to take care of it. And we're going to see the picture of the synagogue in Capernaum here in just a moment. But the synagogue, the word synagogue means gather together. Our equivalent today is church. The Greek word ekklesia means to call out, but it's you're called out to assemble together. In other words, y'all come, the way we would say it in Mississippi. We are the gathered ones. And so you would go, well, let's say it this way. Where's the church? Is that the church? That's what you say often. Let's go to church. Let's go to the church house, to distinguish it from the real church. The people are church, right? You are the worship place. But we also use that word. And so they did the same with synagogue. A synagogue was a building, and it was also the people, just like we use the word church today. So synagogue, when did synagogue begin? There is no consensus on the origin of the synagogue that I could find. But it makes sense that, you remember what happened in 586 B.C.? What? The southern kingdom got conquered by Babylon, right? And they were carried off. And what happened to the temple? Temple was destroyed. Solomon's temple destroyed. So what do you do if you are Jewish and you want to continue being Jewish and celebrating any kind of worship? What do you do? Well, I think that's probably the one of the best ideas of the origin of the synagogue is when they were carried off into exile. And so a group needed to be 10 men, age 12 and over. Yeah, they could form a synagogue. And so synagogue concept sort of developed, and synagogue was a place primarily where you go learn, read the Torah, read the scriptures, or hear it read, and offer prayers and that kind of thing. So not sure where it all began, but the synagogue is, and Jairus is a synagogue ruler, very prominent, and so that's again an important thing. He's a well-known guy in the community. People are going to know about this. People who perhaps who are, if there is such a thing as a well-to-do person in Capernaum, Jairus probably knows about them. So let's go to the picture that I have here. It's a sort of it is an aerial view. If you go into Israel with us in 2 months, we will go there. Let me get my pointers to show you a few things. I've showed you this picture before, but here's the road coming in, and we'll the bus will park right over here somewhere, I think, and we'll walk right down here and go right past that very colorful building. I think I talked to you about it some time ago, that it has stone that is both a lot like what we have here, the limestone, but it also has basalt, is that what they call it? Black stone as well. And so that building right there looks almost like a checkerboard, you know, the black and white playing checkers. Y'all know what I mean, right? And then we walk right in here, go through the gate, and we get to see all these things and whatever. And here's the synagogue. We'll sit under that tree right there, and the guide will talk to us about this little town, fishing village of Capernaum, where Jesus made his headquarters. And we'll get to walk all around, get to walk inside the synagogue and all through here, all these ruins. But you notice out here, these are other ruins that have not been excavated, right? This area here is where they allow you to, you know, walk around and look and whatever. But we'll walk along here. You'll see a number of stones and stuff that had come from probably the synagogue and such. I'll tell you more about that later. I'll just show you a few things. Back up a minute. Back up one more time. I wanted to point out this. It's a modern building. I don't remember the year it was built, but it's a church, actually, built over the top of what they believe was probably Peter's house. See how close Peter lived to the synagogue? Yeah. This strata, this level of ruins that we have here, probably not that of Jesus' day. In fact, when you go up here, they've dug down, and that's where Peter's house was. And so this synagogue is not the one Jesus would have preached from or spoken at, read scripture from, but it's on top of the one in Jesus' day. However, the thing that really strikes my fancy is that we can walk through a gate right over here somewhere and walk right down here along the seashore, and I have no doubt whatsoever, period, that Jesus walked right along the banks of the lake right there. I am convinced that when you walk along there, you can say, I have been right where Jesus was for sure. Can't wait to go again. By the way, we still have some seats available. All right, go to the next picture, and there's a little close, more of a view of the synagogue. The guides tell us all about it. Interesting stuff. So let's go to the scripture. We're going to read in Luke chapter 8, and we're going to get a little, well, some from Mark. Just follow along. Maybe you'll just want to listen. We're going along. We're trying to get to Jairus's daughter, right? So here's the scripture. A large crowd followed and pressed around him. This is Mark chapter 5, verse 25. And a woman was there who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years. Now, how old was Jairus' daughter that we're going to read about in a minute? And this woman had a bleeding issue for 12 years. How many disciples did Jesus have? She had suffered a great deal under the care of many doctors and had spent all that she had, all of her money, yet instead of getting better, she grew worse. And when she heard about Jesus, she came up behind him in the crowd and touched the edge of his cloak, because she thought, if I just touch his clothes, I'll be healed. And immediately, she did touch him, and immediately her bleeding stopped, and she felt in her body that she was freed from her suffering. Note, she was freed from her suffering. So here's the, get the picture, this crowd, they're everywhere. They're crushing in on Jesus, smothering him perhaps. Maybe you would describe them as being very rude. They're just not giving Jesus space at all. And you imagine how forceful and pushy people will be when their lives are at stake. I mean, this man, he can heal. And it's not like going to the hospital and going through all the procedures and stuff and the tests. He touches you and you're healed. So you can imagine that people would be pushing and wanting to get in. They want to be a part of that. They're pushing on. They're trying to get toward Jairus's house, but the 12-year-old little girl is very sick. But as they're trying to get there, their procession, their crowd, it comes to a standstill because this unnamed woman, we don't know who she was, no idea of who she was or what happened to her after that, had this bleeding issue from probably some sort of female problem of some sort that seems to have been quite common. And she has this bleeding and she's wanting to get to Jesus. The law of Moses said in Leviticus 15 that is a custom of these restrictions that she should not have been there. because of her bleeding. She shouldn't be in a social environment. And yet she was taking this great risk to find Jesus and to touch him. She would have been excluded from, you know, going to temple worship. And anyone that she touched would have been unclean as well. But it's, again, it's not just a medical problem. We're very good at differentiating. We say, well, we got a medical problem, or we got a spiritual problem, or but this is not just a medical problem for her. It's a social, emotional problem, and even a religious problem. And so she has suffered for a long time, and it's Mark that gives us more of the information. Remember, who is Luke? What's his profession? He's a medical doctor, right? And if you compare his description of this story and Mark's, you'll find that Luke leaves out the part about she's gone to all these doctors, spent all of her money. It's like Luke is being protective of the profession. You don't want to talk down about doctors, you know, not being able to heal her, but yet they've taken all of her money. And so Luke neglected to tell us that. She suffered a great deal under many doctors and spent all of her money, and yet getting worse instead of better. They can't help her. And I'm not sure how to understand her faith, her belief, whether it's superstition or I'm not sure what, but she is convinced, according to the report, she's convinced that if she touches his garment, his clothes, perhaps it's his prayer shawl, if she touched, then she will be healed. I mean, that's faith, whether it's misplaced faith or not, I don't know. Well, it evidently was not misplaced faith, because she was healed, wasn't she, when she touched his garment. She got the results that she wanted. And Jesus, evidently, he is aware. It says that he sensed the power go out from him. I'm suggesting that he was probably aware that she was there and was about to touch him, but that was not revealed. But her healing came through a deliberate act of faith that if she touched him, he would be healed. And some argue that what she touched was probably the tassels of his cloak, or his prayer shawl, we would call it today. In fact, I think I have a picture. Yeah, here's a picture of a prayer shawl. If you go to Numbers chapter 15, you'll read where God told him to wear a prayer shawl. And the little, what would you call the tassels are there? Moses said that's to remind you of the God's commands. It's not just a covering, because you want to cover yourself in the presence of God, you know, out of respect for him. But those tassels would give you a lot like prayer beads, I would guess you'd think. So just to remind you of God's commands. Because remember, they couldn't just, you know, let me open to Exodus and read the Ten Commandments. Yeah. They didn't have that option like we do today. And so the tassels there were to help them remember. God respected this woman's faith, and it flowed whether her beliefs were superstitious or not. Indeed, it was. In fact, let's look at Numbers. It'd be good for us to do that. Look at Numbers 15. In fact, I probably want to begin a little bit before 38. Verse 37. The Lord said to Moses, so this is God speaking, telling Moses to tell the people, "Speak to the people of Israel and tell them to make tassels on the corners of their garments throughout the generations, and to put a cord of blue on the tassel of each corner, and it shall be a tassel for you to look at and remember all the commandments of the Lord, to do them, not to follow after your own heart and your own eyes, which you are inclined to whore after. So you shall remember and do all my commands and be holy to your God. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt to be your God. I am the Lord your God." So there the Lord spoke to Moses, said, put these tassels to remind you of the commands, because obedience is an a love response. You show your love for God by the fact that you obey. And now I'm going back to Mark chapter 5, verse 30. And at once Jesus realized the power had gone out from him. He turned around in the crowd and he asked, "Who touched my clothes?" And when they denied it, according to Luke, when they all denied it, Peter said, "Master, you see the people crowding around you." And his disciples answered, and yet you can ask, "Who touched me?" It's like they're saying, duh, how do you think anybody, how would anybody know who touched you? All these people pushing around and all over the place. But Jesus said, "Someone touched me. I know that power has gone out from me." And Jesus kept looking around to see who had done it. And then the woman, do you think he really had to look around to see who it was? I think this is a lot like that story of God asking, Adam, where are you? This is giving this woman an opportunity to profess her faith. So he keeps looking around, and then the woman, seeing that she could not go unnoticed, knowing what had happened to her, came and fell at his feet. That sounds a lot like the Gerasene demoniac, doesn't it? Fell at his feet, trembling with fear, told him the whole truth. In the presence of all the people, she told why she had touched him and how she had been instantly healed, according to Luke. He said to her, "Take heart, daughter. Your faith has healed you. Go in peace and be freed from your suffering." Freed from your suffering. I find it interesting that he didn't use the stronger word or more the word for healing specifically, although this word here, translated freed, is oftentimes used in a healing medical context. So Jesus, he's aware that power has gone out, that something has happened, and he invites her to profess her faith that what has happened. And Peter thinks the question is unreasonable. How could anybody know who touched you? Can you imagine that? I mean, if the crowds were as I'm thinking of them, I would think there are people bumping into Jesus all the time. Unless he has some sort of Star Wars force field around him that keep people bubble pushed away. You know what? I doubt that. And so people are touching him. But here's a woman, I think, who has faith. And faith is essential. And she falls at his feet and professes what she's done. And I think Jesus knew who it was, but just wanted to give her, she already had faith, but I think his, who was it? Who touched? Speak up. I think that was an opportunity that Jesus gave her to help her faith grow. Because it is somewhat equivalent to when the preacher preaches, and he preaches the gospel message, confess your sins, repent, and receive Christ as your Savior. Now, come forward and profess to the family your faith in Christ. When you walk forward, your faith develops, it grows. It's one thing to feel the healing power, but it's the next level when you say, "Let me tell you my story of what God has done for me." Oh, again, that sounds a lot like the Gerasene demoniac, doesn't it? Go home to your people and report to them what great things. And so Jesus is here giving this woman the opportunity to do the same thing that he told the Gerasene demoniac to do. But there is a difference that we'll note in a minute. Do you think Jesus was looking her right in the eyes when he said, "Who touched me?" I think maybe he was. But she does profess her faith, and that's exactly what she needed to do. Her faith grows, not to mention the faith of the crowd as well. So she makes that public statement and gives glory to God, which is another reminder that's what it always ought to be, that anytime we experience the grace of God, it's an opportunity for us to give glory to God, to say to everyone, "He touched me." and now I am no longer the same.
So Jesus, speaking kindly, he not only removes her fear, but he bolsters her faith, and also, I think, removes the stigma of her problem. She's been healed, and therefore she can, like the Gerasene demoniac, she can go back into the community, back to her family, because this medical problem that's kept her separated from her family is now gone. This is the only place, I understand, where Jesus addresses anyone as daughter.
We don't have, now is not the time to do it, but I think we would be very shocked at the cultural differences between men and women in most parts of the world today, but also, but back then for sure. And so he says, go in peace. Shalom. Shalom, go in peace. Faith that led to her healing. I want to read another scripture. This one from Jesus' brother, half-brother, we would say, James chapter 5, verse 13. Go there with me if you want to. James chapter 5, verse 13. That's where I'm going to read. Come on, cooperate with me. Is anyone among you suffering? Let him pray. Is anyone cheerful? Let him sing praise. Is any among you sick? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith, that's one, underline that word, the prayer of faith, prayer offered in faith, will save the one who is sick, and the Lord will raise him up. And if he has committed sins, he'll be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person has great power as it is working. Faith. That's important stuff. So, 53. Do we have time to get into, back to the Jairus' daughter? We got sidetracked. That never happens to you, does it? We'll try. Here we go. I am back to the main story, Mark chapter 5 and Luke chapter 8, if you want to go there. But listen, while Jesus is still speaking to the crowd and to this woman, some men came from the house of Jairus, the synagogue ruler, and they said, to Jairus, your daughter is dead. That's a very strong statement. It's not like they said she's passed on, she's gone. No, she's dead. The Greek puts the word dead first to emphasize. Why don't bother the teacher anymore? So ignoring what they said, Jesus told the synagogue ruler, Jairus, father, don't be afraid, just what? Believe. Now remember, in the Greek, the word pistuo or pistis, noun, it can be translated faith, believe, or trust. Trust me. Have faith in me. Believe in me. Same thing, okay? So, in other words, have faith. Just have faith, and she will be healed. He did not let anyone follow him except Peter, James, and John. Those are the three on the inner circle. Peter, James, and John, three disciples. And the brother of James, that is John, the brother of James, and the child's father and mother. Luke includes that part. When they came to the home of the synagogue ruler, interesting that they keep referring to him as synagogue ruler rather than calling him by name, Jesus saw a commotion, and the flute players, with people crying and wailing loudly, he went in into the house, and he said to them, why all this commotion and wailing? Stop wailing. Go away. The child is not dead but asleep. But they laughed at him. This crowd of people laughed at
Jesus, knowing that she was dead. And in other words, the mourners, again, the culture, you know, if when someone dies, people come to the home and they start playing instruments and making loud noises. It's a part of the mourning process, okay? The grieving process. And during the delay, that is while we were out helping this woman who had the gyrus, I'm sure that he was anxious. Jesus, come on, my daughter. And in his frustration, his frustration turned, I think, probably, if I were in his shoes, my frustration would turn to anger when the folks came and said, don't bother the rabbi anymore, your daughter's dead. Can you feel the sadness? And, you know, anger is a natural response to grief, right? To loss. And so he's frustrated, just found out that his daughter died, only daughter, 12 years old. She's dead. The servants are seem to be concerned with Jesus as well as with Jairus. They don't want Jesus to be bothered anymore, whoever these servants of Jairus, I assume. And Jesus just ignores the message that they bring to him. He quickly grabs Jairus' attention, so come go with me, refocusing from his fear and encouraging him to have faith, just believe. And Mark makes it look like Jesus stops the crowd where they are and does not allow anybody else to come. I'm not sure exactly what the process looked like, but Luke says he took Peter, James, and John, and they went into the house with the father and the mother, and evidently others were left outside. And these three, Peter, James, and John, their names will be mentioned numerous times together in the Gospels. In fact, they get the privilege of seeing, you remember the transfiguration up on the mountain? And there again, if you go to Israel and go to the Mount of Transfiguration, some will say it's here and some will say it's there, but also in the Garden of Gethsemane, he calls Peter, James, and John to go with him a little further, and we'll see the place. It's inside a church where they believe that Jesus knelt drops like blood came forth. And so remember, outside the house, there's all this racket going on, the cultural death ritual, and they are gathering to do what they do. That's very opposite of our culture, isn't it? When we have a death, we'll go to the home and we're very solemn, very quiet, very respectful. Totally opposite of this culture, right? But again, that's our purpose, is to see these distinctions. And so Jesus takes Jairus and they get there, and Jesus tells them to stop mourning because she's not dead, she's asleep. He uses that expression elsewhere, you'll remember. In fact, that's the way he talked of his dear friend Lazarus before raising Lazarus from the dead. But can you imagine? People are laughing at him. And think about it. You see somebody that's dead, how do you determine if a person's dead? You feel for a pulse, right? You listen for breath, watch the chest to see if it's moving. I mean, you've done first aid, right? I mean, and there's no indications of life. And somebody says, oh, he's just asleep. No, I know the difference between sleeping and dead, and that person's dead. You remember the story? Oh, it's 7 o'clock. Time to quit. How did it get to be 7 o'clock so quickly? We'll do this and then we'll stop. So he put them all out. He took the child's father and mother. I'm reading Mark chapter 5:40, and the disciples who were with him, and they went to where the child was, and he took her by the hand, and he said to her, Talitha cum, which means little girl, my child, I say to you, get up. And her spirit returned, according to Luke. Luke's the doctor, remember, he wants to be more technical. Her spirit returned, and immediately the girl stood up, walked around. She's 12 years old, I mean, yeah. And at this, her parents were completely astonished, and he gave strict orders not to let anyone know about this.
and told them to give her something to, when he says, don't tell anybody about this, is it, don't tell anybody that she's alive? I mean, they're going to see that. I mean, well, he's probably saying, don't tell people how this happened, I guess. Again, is this paradoxical? That is, don't tell anybody because I'm going to tell you not to tell anybody, but I know you're going to. Or is it, remember over in the Gadara with the Gerasene demoniac, he said, go tell everybody. Go tell your family. And over here, he says, don't tell anybody. There's good reason to be different because over there, he's not over there. That's Gentile territory, right? Over on the other side of the Sea of Galilee. And so, yeah, go tell everybody. But over here, he's already got more people than can get around him. So don't tell anybody. Keep it down. Makes sense to me. So let's stop right there. We'll stop there. We'll come back to Matthew 9:26, how the news spreads throughout. Here we go. Next time we get together, we're going to take a trip. We've been with Jesus when he raised, this is the second person from the dead. We're going to walk now. We're going to walk about 40 miles. So wear your good hiking shoes. Yeah, there's where we're going. We're going to start it up at Capernaum, right? Right on the top of the Sea of Galilee. And we're going to zigzag all around. In fact, that Jesus Trail, look it up when you get home, jesustrail.com. 2007, I think it was, some guy said he wanted to make that trail. And you can do that. You can actually make that walk. I'd love to do that sometime. About 40 miles, so you'd probably want to do it in 2 or 3 days. You know, don't wear yourself out. Maybe a little longer for some. But that's where we'll start when we get back. We had that easy boat ride, rode across, but now we're going to start another tour of that of Galilee. Make sense? We have seen miraculous things tonight. When the Lord of life, says to a dead, lifeless human body, 12-year-old little girl, get up. So let me ask you this. Think about this. How's your faith? Think about your faith in two ways. The quantity, how much, and the quality. Oh, but there's a third element of faith. We'll talk about that next time. Father God, thank you for allowing us the privilege of walking with Jesus tonight. We pray, Lord, that as we continue to walk, we'll grow stronger in our faith because we know you better. Bless us, Lord, to be a blessing to others, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Don't forget to look for the evening star, i.e. Venus.